All right, here we go, folks. Here we go. Welcome to today's guided practice session. You know, these guided practice sessions where we kind of walk in the shoes of masters are my favorite. And today we are walking in the shoes of a modern master. Before we get going, though, just a reminder that everything we do here is sponsored by Open Studio. You can go to openstudiojazz.com to learn more about any of that. But today I'm very excited because we are learning the language of a modern master. Now, there is a PDF you can follow. We're going to be working in SoundSlice, which is the browser-based software that we use around here in Open Studio for pretty much everything. And so you can follow along live on the video. But if you want to download the PDF of this amazing bit of language we're going to work on from the great Gerald Clayton, you can download that here. There's a link in the description, a link in the chat. And let's get right to it. I'm so excited about this. If you don't know, Gerald Clayton's playing very well. First of all, where have you been? But secondly, it's just so like natural and beautiful and organic and but still like virtuosic and all the things we love about our great masters, this, you know, young master has. So let's learn a little bit of the language of this modern master, Gerald Clayton. That's a cool pick too, isn't it? All right, let's get to it. So today we are going to be learning a bit of his solo from his version of Autumn Leaves, which is from his album, 2009 album Bond, the Paris Sessions. You got to check out the whole album. It's incredible. And so I highly encourage you to, wherever you get your music, go get this record. It's so, so good. But we're just going to check out this solo of Autumn Leaves. And there's a couple of things. We'll listen to it here straight away. This was transcribed by the great Max Gamiz, our Open Studio resident transcription guru. So I know it's going to be good. But just notice the odd bits of this solo and see if you can see what's happening here as we start it. Let's listen to it first. Here it is. Like that. I mean, this like effortless fluidity between these time signatures, it's just so masterful, and somehow it is not jarring to me at all. It's not off-putting or feels mathematical at all. It feels completely natural. If you haven't caught what's going on here, so they start with the first sort of A and B section, right? The melody, and then how the melody and all the things you are, how it's restated up a fourth, down a fourth. That's all in 7-4, which is, you've heard like Brad Mehldau does it in 7-4. Like it's that's a pretty typical way to play Autumn Leaves. Like anything actually that's kind of whole note based like that, like measure based, it's kind of easy to put in 7. So like you can think about it in those big movements of half notes and then dotted quarter notes. Da da ba do do ba da ba ba do, right? And then, but that's not, they don't stop there. Gerald doesn't stop there. In the bridge, right? 6-4, which means now we have essentially like two dotted half notes. Hold on, let's hear it. Let's get the meter. So it goes, so like So almost like a slow three, or it is 6-4 there. Then, but they don't stop there. That's not the end of it either. Then at the end here, 5-4, which I think they're kind of feeling it like dotted quarter note. Well, let's hear it. It could be like, I think it's kind of like, dot a half note and then half note. Like three beats and then two beats. For the last A every time, right? And then back to seven. So did you hear that? So that last A is like a 1-2-3-1-2-1-2-3-1-2-1-2-3-1-2-1-2-3-1-2-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. Back to seven when it gets to the top of form. So the form is the same way every time when you listen to this album. The A section and the B section, which is really AA, right? It's just the A restated, a fourth below, a fifth above, is in 7-4. The bridge is in that 6-4. And then the last A section, or the D section, I guess, technically, is in 5-4, which is like 1-2-3-1-2-1-2-3-1-2. So it's like it shrinks. Isn't that hip? It shrinks down. So like the start of it is in 7, very wide, and then shrinks to 6, and then shrinks to 5. This is brilliant. This is so brilliant. This takes a lot of work to be able to do that. So we're not gonna do that today. We're not gonna do this whole thing. We're not gonna go between the times and you just we're not gonna do anything easy though. What we're gonna be doing is fairly advanced because I wanna hit one of the 7-4 sections, the last 7-4 section. But let's listen to it all again and then see if you can pick that out. By the way, if this is the kind of thing you wanna see me do more of, hit the like button, because I do pay attention to that kind of stuff. If you like the sort of modern master stuff, I love it. But you know, I care what you think too. So let me know by hitting that like button. And let's listen to this again. Now 6-4. Now 5-4. So awesome. The 6-4 feels so good and even when you get there, because everything else is so odd, you know? Whew. And the language is so, like I said, it's effortless. This is what we're doing, by the way, this section here. Because I want to learn that. He's almost doing like four dotted quarter notes at times. So it's so great. We'll listen to it again at the end, that whole solo. I encourage you to, again, listen to this whole album, Bond, the Paris Sessions, just from start to finish, amazing, from one of the great pianists of this generation. So what are we going to do today? Today, we are going to learn the first two A's of the last chorus. So this is all in 7-4, and this is really what I want to work on, is this section, because there's a lot of like really hip two-handedness. Like he's passing the solo between the hands a lot and using a lot of really cool rhythmic things in 7-4. Also, I want to work on my 7-4. I don't do a lot of like odd meter playing in my own music that I make, but it's always good to kind of expand that and work on it. So you just gotta do it. That's the thing with odd meters. You think like, oh, how do I work on odd meters? You just do it. You just do it again and again. It's like anything else. How did you work on chords? How did you work on the blues scale? You just do it and do it and do it. And that's the same thing with odd meters. It just takes repetition. Again, shout out to Max Gamiz for the amazing transcription here. Max is our in-house transcription guru, and he's just incredible. So this is what we're doing today. This is what we're going to learn. Probably not full speed. Right? That's easy. It goes by in a flash. Let's hear it again. Oh. One more time. Hmm. So a couple of things, some intentions I want to set here as I get into this, right? What I want to do. I really want to get the feel that Gerald Clayton gets here. I want to get that this very articulated rhythmic feel that's happening in this section in particular. I think for, it was intentionally articulated like that for sure. But I want to really make sure that I'm, you know, on that same plane as I'm doing this, even if we're doing it slowly, right? The other thing I'm thinking about, as my friend Peter Martin is commenting, reading my mind here, is like, I'm thinking about this area of the piano. How can I apply this tenor range of the piano down here, right? Like this, all this stuff that's, right? That's something that we don't maybe naturally gravitate towards or think about all the time, but using the range of the piano in our solo can be an incredible way to just like inspire us, break us out of, you know, a rut of what we might normally play. I'm going to be thinking about that as I'm learning this and just working on getting down there, right? And then seeing like thinking about how can I use this in my regular improvisation? All as I'm learning this language of a modern master, right? This amazing player, Gerald Clayton. And then we'll break down some of, there's a couple of little theoretical hipness happening here that we can talk about, but I'm not super worried about any of that actually. I really just, like I said, the thing with these, with when we're doing these transcriptions from these master players is really just like spending time with them, right? Like walking in their shoes for a bit. It can be so helpful. So let's check it out. So again, this is the top of a chorus here. We'll do the little bit of the two beats leading up to it, right? And so again, the meter we're thinking here is 4 and 3. So you might think two half notes and then two dotted quarter notes. I think that's the sort of clave that the rhythm section is feeling like that. And they're way more fluid than this. That's not just like they're mechanical about it. But for us, it could help us because I think that's kind of what they're basing it off of. That dunt, unt, 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 right? That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's a very common way to count 7/4. So I'm going to kind of be thinking that too as we get into this. Okay, let's try it. We're going to dial it way back. Let's try 50% and just hear how this sounds. You can hear that clave. You can hear that in that. You can hear that clave in the last part of the beat from the bass, and you can see it here actually, just going that slow. You can all of a sudden see it here in Gerald's line. Check out every time he hits the da go go ga go ga go do ga on the last three beats. Here in the G7 flat 9, da go do ga go do 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 go do, and then he plays straight through here. But in the C minor 7 and F minor 7, da go do go da go do go da go do ga go do. So that really is, and then in the next bar, do ga do da go do go da ga da ga go do. That's really like lending itself. Okay, that's what they're thinking. Da 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 go do go da go do da go do do. That's very helpful as we learn this to know that that's kind of how they're breaking down the 7/4 bar. Again, that's probably the most common way that people break down 7/4. You don't count like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Some people count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, which is, that's a good way to do it too. No, but most people do it this way. So let's try that again. Let's just listen again very slowly. Here. Do it again. Let's just sing the rhythm together. Da-da. It really helps to be able to feel that. Let's try it again. Let's try to play it for the first time. So just getting the language here. Sight reading. So let's go. Maybe let's go just phrase by phrase, right? See if we can get this first phrase. That's pretty easy. Let's actually see if we can get the first two through here. First two bars. Again, still pretty easy. So maybe I'll get through here. I'll get through the first part of the C7. That should work. See if I can. Shout out to SoundSlice for being very easy to use for this kind of stuff. Again, you can check out the PDF here. Download the PDF and follow along to the whole solo. We actually have every chorus here. So let's try it again. So I'm just going to work out, where I'm going to do this in my hands down here on this, because everything up to that D flat is pretty simple, but to that D flat, I'm probably going to do 5, 2, 1 in my left hand, and then 1, 2, 3, like just an arpeggio. Yeah. Let's try it again. Just practicing that. Let's just loop that. I think I got it. Let's try it again slowly. This is tough. This is really hard to do. Let's try it again. Again. Ah. Got the timing wrong. Let's see if we can get the next bar. The next bar is also pretty complicated. I'm going to do these two bars here. So I think what's going on here, I'm going to finger this, like this E here, I'm going to start with my right hand and just do 1, 2, 4 and then take that up the octave, right? I would bet that's what's going on. I don't know for sure, but I would bet that's what's going on. And then back down. Okay, let's try it again. One time. Ah. Okay. Oh, it's exciting. It's exciting. Let's try it again. Let's see if we can get all of this. Ah, it's so great. Let's do it again. Ah. Awesome. Oh my gosh, this language is so cool. All right, we're gonna do this next, we're almost done with it actually. This happened fast. So I'm gonna get through the next bar here. And it's almost, there's definitely like, that's some bebop happening here. You know what I mean? That's for sure. Bebop alive and well. Yeah, let's try that again. It's so cool. Okay, let's do this much. Here we go. Getting it. Hitting an A natural there on the F sharp or on the F minor, but it's an it's an A flat. All right, let's see if we can we're so close. Let's see if we can keep going here on the B flat 7. I gotta switch to bass clef, which my brain hurts. Okay, so that's, but here's what I'm thinking as I read this line: G and then B flat, B natural, G flat. I'm thinking altered. Right, I'm thinking down that B melodic minor. Just gotta get that in my hands here. That's a B flat and that's an E flat. All right, let's try that. Let's try this much here. There it is. Let's do it again. I think I got it. Let's try that whole thing. Oh, so much fun. Take a look at some nerdy harmonic things that are going on here, melodic and harmonic things. So here, right on the F minor 7, it starts with like this major third, which is super hip, and then it just stays diatonic here, although this E flat 7 has this D natural, which resolves very nicely to D flat then to A, right, which is a nice little just chromatic walk down thing. And then check it out here, the D flat, just all D flat, but lands on the D flat on that G7 flat 9, you know, which is the sharp 11, so that makes sense. So the natural 13. And then check it out on the C major 7, it's actually C major 7 sharp 11. Because we have this F sharp in here. It's a little chromaticism there. And then the bebop language here on the C minor 7. And then the altered scale language on the B flat 7. Right, just going straight down. It's going straight down. That's just all B melodic minor. Whew. Now let's check out what's about to happen in the last two bars of what we're learning here. A flat, major 7. Gerald's going to play like a C major triad. This is so hip, by the way. C major triad. Don't forget your Chopin etudes, folks. C major triad on the way up here. Let me turn back my, turn on my camera. I'm over it. C major triad on the way up, starting on G, right? All the way up to that. And that C major triad over A flat major, it makes sense, right? You have the seventh and the third of A flat major, but you also have the sharp five, giving it a nice like augmented, major augmented sound. So that's gonna be very nice. Let's try doing what we have so far all the way through, or well, at least to the end here from the C major. Just off beats there at the end. Let's try it again. Oof. Wait, are those A flats? E flats? Hold on, hold on. It's a C minor triad. That's my bad. I got confused with the clef. Well, that's cool too. It happens. Now I gotta relearn it though. Yeah, maybe next time try a C major triad? I'm just kidding. I think we have the whole thing at this tempo. It's time to bring it up to tempo, though. Let's try the whole thing. Here we go. I bet when I said it goes up the C major triad, Max was like, what? Sorry, Max. We got it. We got it, though. We got to take care of. Here we go. Let's try it again. do with this, all of this information, learning this? Why even learn it? Why bother to learn it? Well, so first of all, just the act of learning it is really, really great for our musical brain. Like, that's why we learn music from records. Some people call it transcribing, but what we're doing here isn't transcribing. We're just, again, we're kind of like hanging out with Gerald Clayton on this section of this tune, just sort of walking in his footsteps, breathing the air that he's breathing, trying to kind of get inside where he might be in his mind and his body as he's playing this. And it's a very, very cool way to connect to the music. We're also learning some things, but, you know, we say around here all the time, you can't information your way to being a better player. So trying to come up with like what's the theory behind this and what, like, analyzing it, that's not the important bit at all. In fact, that's like the least important bit. The important bit is just kind of like hanging out with the master as they're playing this, playing with them in their footsteps. And we absorb so much more than our conscious minds, like our intellectual brains, can handle. I mean, there is that too, and that's important. I'm not saying it's not important, but I think the real important thing is just being with it and sort of vibing out with the music and using this as like a springboard. Like, I'm already coming up with ideas based on this that is like a jumping off point for my own exploration into playing in seven over all the things you are. Yeah, it's giving me ideas, but more than like the scale and note choices are giving me ideas, like the way it feels and the vibe of it is giving me a lot of great ideas. And just being with that, I think for me, is the important bit. Let's see if we can. So some of these things are going to start to get really clear as we increase the speed. Let's try it at 60%. Again. Dare we? Let's try it. Try 80%. Oh, we got it. Again, I'm really thinking now as we pick up the tempo and the sort of track becomes clearer and the intentions behind it come clearer, we can kind of pick up that staccato rhythm. It's going to get tough though. Here we go. Eighty percent. time. One more time at 80. I got to find my place here before I start. Oh, I got to try that again. It's so hard. That beginning, it's a little bit, the beginning of the chorus is not, they're like, it's not exactly clear to me where I am there. So I got to keep going back to it. Let's try it again. That's so much fun. When you can kind of ride that wave, it's so much fun. Let's try it again. 90%. Here we go. I'm just going to listen this first time. Huh. 90%. Here we go. One more time. Ah, it feels great. Ah, it feels, shake it out. It's 90%. Let's do one more bit, 100%. Aspirational at best, maybe. It's gonna be fun though, let's try it. Not bad, better than I thought I would. So, you know, it doesn't have to be 100% on our first time out, but that sure is fun to try, isn't it? Isn't it amazing? You can download the PDF of this whole transcribed solo from All the Things You Are from Gerald Clayton's Bond, the Paris Sessions. So great. Thanks, Max Gamiz, for the transcription. Just amazing. Thanks, Gerald Clayton, for the music. So beautiful and effortless and seamless. You can also, I think you can get the SoundSlice link here, too, if you want to come play along with the SoundSlice and use SoundSlice to practice this and slow it down and loop it and all that stuff that I just did. Really, really fun. Again, let me know if this is the kind of thing you like by hitting the like button, and I can do more of these super cool Modern Master series. You know, we like to do the classics too. We like to do, your Hank Jones and your bebop stuff is all coming up. We're going to be doing it again. But yeah, thanks very much, everybody. Download the PDF. And until next time, happy practicing.